Hello everyone, hi, welcome to the channel of Wall Street Mojo.
Watch the video till the end, and also if you are new to this channel, then you can subscribe us by clicking the bell icon.
Friends, today we are going to learn a topic that is basically EBITDA. Every stakeholder is always interested in this particular driver that's called EBITDA. Why? Let's get into this. Let's get into the nitty-gritty of the same. EBITDA is basically a measure of earning before paying interest and taxes, arrived at by adding back the non-cash expenditures, which are your depreciation and amortization. So this is what you can see over here, but let's understand this in a complete detail form. Now, EBITDA is basically a measure of earning, which is before paying your interest, taxes, okay? I'll just write over here I and T, sounds much better. Arrived at after adding back any depreciation, you have to add back any depreciation and you have to add back any amortization because those are the non-cash expenditure and is widely utilized as a measure of a company's operating performances. So there are certain drawbacks as well to this measure, and looking at it in isolation can give a less accurate idea of the company's actual earning than would be desired. So, friends, there's a graph over here. Alphabet EBITDA, that is Google's EBITDA, has increased over the last 10 years. This is the year, and over here, this is the EBITDA. What you can see from the above graph that we know that Google's EBITDA has increased 274% from, it started from 8.13 billion in 2008, close enough to, and it has reached to $30.42 billion in 2016. Look at the increase. Now that we understand that what EBITDA is, we can look at the methods for calculating the EBITDA. Let's start on this particular note. The first and foremost thing that we are going to go through is the formula. So the EBITDA formula goes something like this. EBITDA is equal to your operating profit. Once you have your operating profit, what you can do, you can add back, you have to basically add any depreciation because that's a non-cash expenditure. Then you have to add amortization on this. Once you add back amortization, what you get is EBITDA. So this is the first formula. And here it would be useful to get an idea on the financial terms. We are using it to be able to understand earning before interest, tax, depreciation and amortization and its calculation better. It essentially refers to the profit basically that is earned from the company's core operations. That is, we all know that's known as EBIT, right? That is earning before interest and tax, which gives a fair idea of a company's ability to generate profits while removing any earnings other than those from the core operations. Like for instance, a company might be earning from its investments, from investments and from the sale of the asset as well, but these types of earnings are excluded from the operating profit. Now let's see how this thing is being calculated. I'll take an example over here for the same so that you have some idea. Operating profit or EBIT, let's see how it is calculated. First, operating profit, that is the earning before interest and tax, that is EBIT, is basically equal to what? Your revenue less any expenses. Right. So let us suppose that a company has reported a sales or revenue of, let's say, 30 million for a certain fiscal year, and the operating expense amounted to, let's say, 12 million. So here the company's operating profit, that is the EBIT, is going to be how much? As simple as that, 30 minus 12, that is your 18, is your EBIT. So here the company's EBIT is 18 million. These expenses includes basically depreciation, amortization, salaries and utilities, cost of goods sold, along with the general administrative expenses, right? So let's understand the next term, depreciation, in this, because we are in a flow. So let's understand that. Depreciation is basically the cost of the company's assets, which is allocated over its duration of useful life. This includes any tangible assets like building, machines, equipments, and so on and so forth. Now, let's suppose that a company has purchased because you're taking example over here of depreciation. Let's suppose a company has purchased some assets with a worth of lifetime of 10 years. Let's say this, the life is 10 years. I'm just writing L over here. If the tangible assets, let's say it's machinery, which is costing, the cost of the machinery is, let's say, 6 million. Right. So then we can calculate the yearly depreciation expenses by dividing the total cost divided by the number of years, that is the life of the asset, which gives us 6 lakh as the annual depreciation expenses. The same goes with amortization. It only differs from the depreciation in that it is allocation of company's intangible assets. So when we talk about depreciation, it is for tangible assets. And when we talk about amortization, we are talking about intangible assets. As simple as that. This intangible assets include intellectual rights, goodwill, and so on and so forth. Suppose, let's say the company intangible assets is the same. Take it this way. 6 million and 10 years. Again, the answer is going to be 6 lakh, right? So this is the only difference. Let's take one example on the above formula that we have learned to calculate the EBITDA. To calculate the EBITDA, it would be important to note that earnings, interest and taxes of the firm are reported on the income statement, whereas the depreciation and amortization figures can be found in the cash flow statement or in the profit and loss account. Now, we have already calculated EBIT in our example. Let's take this one step further and let's assume that the operating profit of the firm over here is, let's say, 18 million. And let's say the depreciation cost, I'll just copy this thing down over here. EBIT is, let's say, 18 million. And we have depreciation, let's say, as 6 lakh. So I'll just write 0.6. And the amortization expense, let's say it is 4.5 million. Then the EBITDA can be calculated in the following fashion. EBITDA is basically 18 million plus you need to add back depreciation plus your amortization. So that's your $19.05 million. Now, after learning the formula, let's understand how this EBITDA can be manipulated. This is very important. See, can EBITDA be manipulated to show the inflated earnings? See, as we have already hinted above, like, you know, in our case, different methods of calculating EBITDA have created a lack of clarity among investors about the reliability and the credibility of the metric. So it is evident from the illustration that we have learned that simply by defining operational profit and income differently and including or excluding income from the non-core operations, it would be possible to arrive at drastically varying figures of EBITDA. Based on this, we can make our final conclusion that on our analysis, we can easily understand that EBITDA may not be the most reliable metric for the measuring operating profit or profitability, especially if it is used in isolation. However, if it is used with a little care, it could well be used to evaluate the corporate profitability when used along with the other reliable data and figures. And it allows for different firms to be compared for their debt repayment capability as well. So the ability to service the debt is the most important component for the survival and growth of any business. And the net debt to EBITDA ratio can be pretty useful in measuring this ability. So having said that, one must keep in mind that shortcomings of earning before interest, tax, depreciation and amortization while making use of it, one of the primary issues being that is not accurate indicator of the operating cash flows of any company. So this is because it does not take into account any changes in working capital. This is really crucial, which is a key determinant in the context of the operating cash flow for a firm. And another concern, as we have already discussed in the beginning of the tutorial, is about EBITDA being a non-GAAP. It's a non-GAAP metric which makes it susceptible to be to manipulations by companies in a bid to show higher profitability than there is. So if there is a limitation, if this limitations are kept in mind, there is no reasons why earning before interest, tax, depreciation and amortization cannot be used by analysts as the additional tool of evaluating and comparing the profitability of the firm along with studying and comparing the ability to service debt.
So that's it for this particular topic. If you have learned and enjoyed watching this video, please like and comment on this video and subscribe to our channel for the latest updates. Thank you, everyone. Cheers.